This podcast is a member of the Voices of Wrestling Podcasting Network. Visit voicesofwrestling.com to hear the rest of our great podcasts, as well as show reviews, columns, opinions, and updates across the world of wrestling.
Hey there, Thunder Buddies and Travelers Down Thunder Road. We're back, Days of Thunder, for another special Nights of Nitro episode. We're excited, are you? This is definitely one we had planned for ages and didn't get bullied into by the Discord. It's me, Dave Ryan, joined by, as usual, Stagger Lee Malone. Lee, how are you?
Not happy. I don't want to be here.
We said it's... it feels like one of those like classic bits in a movie or a sitcom where it's like,
I'm absolutely not going to do it.
Scene transition and we're doing it.
Yeah. I was just going to say, remember that last episode we did where we said we're definitely not watching this Nitro?
This very podcast, I said those words, we're not watching this.
But we might watch the Asylum bits.
Yeah. And then the episode dropped. And look, you know, we joke, but like it was quite helpful that your friend and mine, WebCon, let us know in the Discord.
What was helpful?
Well, like I kind of would have been, for historical sake, if nothing else, I would have been annoyed if we missed this. He let us know that there was actually, in addition to Flair and the Asylum, there was two world title changes on this show, so we kind of at that point were like, fuck,
there was actually three world title changes on this show.
I guess so, yes. But we'll get to that in due course. Pal, how have you been?
I'm good. I feel refreshed. Maybe a trip to Nitro wasn't the worst thing to happen this week.
No.
And, no. In a good mood. I was itching to record the show, and then we had some technical difficulties.
Yeah. We thought we were going to have to sack the whole thing off. I've been cursed twice this week. I was to guest on another podcast, which will hopefully still be coming out in the near future. And that got scattered to the winds because it was incredibly, like, surprisingly stormy yesterday evening, and I was trapped on the far side of Dublin, so I was going to miss my window to record. Hopefully going to get a chance at that one, so I won't reveal it just yet what it was going to be. And tonight, your PC decided, I actually don't fancy it, mate.
Yeah, so you got delayed because, you know, transport's just not friendly to you these days. And then my laptop decided that, I've been on for the last 4 hours, and 2 minutes before we log in to start the call, it needs fucking 25 minutes of updates. So, yay technology.
It's one of those nights. I'm trying not to touch anything in case it all goes fucking pear-shaped. In fact, you know, I'm going to be really professional now and do something I realized we hadn't done. And we're going to try no-sell this as I hit record on the Zoom and the scary Zoom lady shouts at us.
It's funny. As soon as you went, I'm going to do something we forgot to do, I went, oh, yeah.
Yeah. We always set up the backup recording just in case.
And I was just going to say, like, I have the Audacity file literally at the bottom of the screen underneath your lovely face.
Yeah. So, unfortunately, like, if we do have to revert to the backup recording, everybody's just missed a couple of minutes of absolutely fucking sizzling banter. But, you know, we will have to struggle on. Speaking of struggling, I have been on the struggle bus this week. My illness of the last week can be charted in podcast form. We recorded twice last week, one of which was me going, "Joe, I think I'm a bit under the weather." And then the second podcast that we did behind the paywall over at largemanappears.com, the latest rehash of the Champions episode, I was full on dying on my arse. And then I recorded my other podcast over the weekend, Linked to the Cast, where I was starting to feel semi-human again, but I'm recovered now. I feel like an incredibly old man when I say, Jesus, there's a bad dose going around this year. but I guess this was like the first flu I've had since COVID started. So I guess I haven't really, apart from when I had COVID in April, I haven't really been sick, properly sick, in 3 years. So I won't complain too much. But it makes sense that like the first time I get properly sick, it absolutely puts me on my arse.
Yeah, I think a lot of people are going to have that, where the first time they get sick, it's going to really knock them for six.
Yeah, I've come over the other side. I've lived to tell the tale, and we've got 3 full hours of Nitro to talk about. Yeah, that's what we've got on the slate this week. We never thought we'd be here, but here we are, back with more Nitro.
Remember when you charted out all the Nitros we were going to watch, and there was like, what, 7 of them?
There's a good few in 2000, none of which are there for good reasons, really.
Yeah, but early on when we looked, we went, we'll do that Nitro. We're going to skip this one. We're going to do that one.
Yeah.
We're already up to 6, and it's not...
I think the ones we have planned since day one were the Goldberg title switch in the Georgia Dome, Warrior in the Mirror.
Yes. Which you wanted to do, by the way.
Yeah. Spring Break 2000, that's the Wall Brother.
Mm-hmm.
The Russo Reset.
Yes.
And Russo's Revenge.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So those were the 5.
I think there was one or two more sprinkled in. But we're already at 6, and it's not even the middle of 1999.
I know, yeah. It's bad. It's bad. But look, before we get into that, I think it's time to take it up to the Days of Thunder Control Center and leave alone.
Thanks, Dave. Here at Days of Thunder Towers, we are constantly looking for ways to give the Thunder Buddies what they want. And the month of November really is shaping up to be the busiest month ever on alargemanappears.com. Just last week, we released Rehash of the Champions 5, the 5th installment in our series revisiting every single NWA and WCW era Clash of the Champions. And still to come later in the month, we will have Black and Golden Days Episode 2, where we travel back to Season 2 of NXT as we work our way through the NXT back catalogue towards the much lauded network era that we have christened the Black and Golden Days. Lonely Audio will also return before the end of the month. And speaking of returning, Pick Your Poison will make its long-awaited return and its first Patreon appearance, as they will have a very special guest to discuss a wrestler of their choosing who is a current member of the WCW roster in our timeline. This show will be available on enlargemanappears.com for free, that's right, for free, to everyone listening to this show. And because that just isn't enough, on the evening of Saturday, November 19th, Dave and myself will be live on patreon.com/WCW Thunderpod for the pre-show of AEW Full Gear, where we will preview the show, give our predictions, and maybe even have some snack talk. It's a loaded November, and all for just $5, as well as access to our entire back catalogue, including Days of Thunder at the Movies, Rehash of the Champions, Grab Bag Radio, Thunder Request Live, and much, much more. That's patreon.com/WCW Thunderpod. And now I return you to your regularly scheduled podcast.
The new boy in the neighborhood lives downstairs, and it's understood. He's there just to take good care of me, like he's one of the family. Charles in charge of our days and our lives. Charles in charge of our wrongs and our rights.
Shut the hell up, Ted, it's morning.
This is Nitro Edition 189 from Fargo, North Dakota, from the 26th of April, 1999, getting a 3.9 rating. I was surprised when I saw that rating, Lee, that in my head, I thought the ratings for Nitro and Thunder were going to be much further apart. But we're talking like three twos and three threes on Thunder,
mm-hmm.
and you're talking in around the 3.8, 3.9, 4 for Nitro. So it's like just wrestling is fucking doing bananas numbers, even though like obviously WCW is on the decline.
Yeah, I think it's the fact that Thunder hasn't fully tanked, but Nitro has started to tank a little bit from its great heights, I should
it's
say.
It's Nitro coming down to meet Thunder on the way
and
down.
And Thunder hasn't started the fucking steep decline it will go through.
No. Did you get the sense from this show... Actually, no, first question. Did you think, as I thought, that this wasn't a bad Nitro?
That's a loaded question.
Yeah, there's bad stuff on
it. There's a lot of bad stuff on what is an easy show to watch.
An easy show to watch, and it has, I think in terms of star ratings, the highest individual high I've seen on a Nitro so far.
I can't say I enjoyed it though either. I can't say it's a good show.
Yeah.
It's peculiar.
It's interesting, it's peculiar, it's very watchable, and delivers at least one absolutely class match, which we'll talk about. Did you get the feeling from this show that a lot of stuff, in particular, I know they did it all the time at Nitro, but particularly this week, a lot of stuff was being hot-shotted to pop a rating?
Yes. Yeah, very, very much so. This was also one of those shows that I think you can watch in retrospect and look and go, they had no idea what was going out next to the ring. Everything was literally written on the back of a fucking postage envelope.
Yeah.
And just, it was total fly by the seat of your pants and let's just fucking get to the next thing.
I was so curious because I was like, why do they seem so desperate? Like you said, like they're writing and rewriting the show in the middle of it. Like they're really desperate to feel like they have to beat Raw tonight or they have to draw eyes away from Raw. Can you guess, based on the time period, if you haven't looked it up before, what would have been on Raw tonight?
The end of April. Was it Austin's first appearance on Raw? No, it was 1999, so it wasn't even post neck break. It was...
It's a famous Raw angle.
Is it the Stephanie crucifixion?
It is. It's the Black Wedding.
Mm.
Which, like, yeah, like it's a big, for that time, like it's a big draw. We are just after, I think we're just after Backlash now.
Yes.
So I
was thinking Backlash 2000. That's where he comes back and gets a huge pop. And
yeah. So Austin is on the show, but the big thing I saw that stood out about the 26th of April Raw is the Black Wedding. So they obviously had the shits up them that was like such a spectacle, such a weird spectacle. After the where to, Stephanie, that they were going to need to try and do something a bit special, because I can't, even for them at this time, it was unusual to do two world title switches on one show.
It's so so peculiar that Ryan Satin chose the Triple H wedding to cosplay as for his real wedding instead of the Black Wedding.
I know, shocking, really. Mm. Like, it was right there the whole time. The show opens, cold open on a graphic, and that's the kind of memorial for Rick Rude. I thought we were going to get a 10-bell salute, but we didn't.
No, we got like 3 or something.
Yeah, I was just waiting for the 10, but no. And then, classy as ever, they segue directly from an actual man has died to Ric Flair is in the asylum. So it's a flashback to Nitro last week, isn't it?
It's a full on recap of the recap they gave us on Thunder.
Yeah,
And it's not the last time we'll see this full on recap.
It's more stylized. They just showed us the angle, didn't they? On
they showed this exact video, which went from all the Flair Piper stuff straight into all the Nash Goldberg DDP stuff. And yeah, like I say, we got this whole video on Thunder to get us updated on what happened on Nitro. Yeah. And then we come to Nitro and get a recap of the recap. And later on, we'll get a recap of the recap of the recap.
Yeah. Like, you know, if they had just shown it the one time on this show, wouldn't be so annoyed about it. Because, again, we always err on the side of, like, I'd rather more recap video packages than less. But, yeah, like, doing it twice on the same show when you've done it on the show before is really excessive.
Total time filling.
Yeah, we just to remind everybody, Flair is committed to an asylum, which we will see a lot tonight. But also, he's announced that he's going to wrestle Piper at Slamboree, putting control of the company up on the line. And then we get the replay of the DDP versus Goldberg thing. And then we get to the asylum, Lee. Have you seen these clips before, or had you just like read about them in Death of WCW, or...
I've seen them. Yeah, I again, it's one of these things. I think I was aware of it in real time, and it's probably something I watched then, like, a long time ago.
Yeah. Do you know, here's my thing about it. Like, it's obviously bad, and I don't think, you know, the idea of putting your president and somebody who was just world champion and somebody the level of star that Ric Flair is in an asylum for a week, is just, it's a horrible idea. It's not good. It doesn't get over. It serves no purpose whatsoever. It doesn't make me more excited to see him versus Piper. Well, to be fair, I don't think anything could make me excited to see the two of them wrestle each other in 1999. It serves very little purpose. But one of the things I'm most disappointed by is that they didn't go weird enough, Lee. Like, it wasn't even so bad and odd, it was really funny. Like, there's a couple of moments where I'm like, okay, like, if they get a bit wacky here, I'm here for it. Like, if they make it a full-on cartoon, or if they try to commit to a full Cuckoo's House parody, I'm on board for it. But they don't, like, it's just... They have this one scene, which is, I suppose, the only actual sketch, like proper scene, in the hospital with Rick at the start. And then the rest of it is just periodically Charles Robinson calling him and him just barking instructions down at the phone. And you see maybe about 5 seconds of what's going on in the hospital after that.
Yeah, it's... like you say, it's kind of a half-assed. They never really commit to it, funnily enough.
Yeah,
it's just bad. I don't know, like, the one purpose the whole thing serves is to introduce us to Asia.
Yeah.
Which, when that's your legacy. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So the first scene starts with, it feels like these segments were being recorded live, because it started with everybody missing their cue.
Dead air.
Yeah, like, if this wasn't recorded live, whoever edited this needed to be sacked immediately.
Well, here's how you know it was recorded live, Dave, because when they would cut to Ric Flair on the phone to Charles Robinson, I don't know if you noticed this, but they have the old-style TV in the middle of the room. You can see Ric Flair on the phone on the TV.
Amazing.
So they were literally broadcasting Nitro to this set.
Okay, they absolutely did not have to do that.
No.
But whatever. So they're waiting too long for the scene to start. Like, the principal actors, the doctor and the nurse, are just fucking standing there for ages. There's three things in this scene that made me laugh. And it was, like, not out loud, were little chuckles.
I was going to say, none of them could have been intentional.
A couple of them were.
Okay.
I was looking at the background, and like all the patients in the hospital had done various art projects that were up on the wall, and one of them was Rick's, and Rick just did his own name in giant letters.
Okay.
I liked that it was inferred quite strongly in this scene that to make Ric Flair appear, you need only play his music.
Yeah, that was good.
Like, he's the fucking Candyman, and you have to say his name in the mirror, and he'll appear. Or, like, he's fucking Joe Hendry in Impact at the moment. Say his name, and he'll appear. And it was just like, you just, one of the patients starts playing Rick's music on something. I didn't write down what it was he started playing it on. And as soon as it starts playing, Nate appears.
In the doorway, in
the doorway, in the boxers he was wearing last week on Nitro, white cotton socks and his robe, and that's it. That didn't necessarily make me laugh because that's been taken away. That's not unusual. And it's not unusual for the man to be stripped to his underwear on live television. The other thing that made me chuckle is that the guy who like played his music and is constantly sticking around him in this, he nicknamed Triple A.
Triple A, yeah.
That's pretty good. I like that.
Now, do you think he's called AAA because he's a skinnier version of Aaron?
That's why I thought he did.
That's what I thought it was as well, yeah.
And that is it. Like, bravo. That's a good gag. That's a very strong gag. So, yeah, he's in his robes. He says AAA is the man and that it's Nitro time. The nurse had said that Nitro wasn't going to be allowed because it makes everyone too agitated. But Nate is clearly running the place.
He is the president of the United States.
Yes, he is the president of the United States. Then we get our new Nitro graphic and video presentation to kick off the show. What did you think about it?
I'm on record as saying I don't mind this era of Nitro presentation. I don't mind it.
Yeah.
Intro.
Yeah. But what did you think about like the actual Nitro like intro video, like not just the WCW?
Yeah, content? It's fun. Yeah.
Yeah, I think I felt weird about like...
Like, the original is so... Like, it is classic, but I liked that they kind of changed. Like, things have to change.
No, totally agree with that. I just don't know if, like, Nitro Girls floating in, like, some sort lava. Of spaceship was it. And lava, yeah. So, JJ and Robinson are in the president's office, and tonight, Lee... Charles is in charge. So he was apparently named executive vice president before Flair went to hospital, and now, much like the the 25th amendment, if the president is incapable of acting his carrying out his duties, the vice president takes his place. So that's what they're playing off. Yeah, the 25th Amendment. In the case of removal of the president from office on his death or resignation, the vice president shall become president. So that's what they're playing off. Charles Robinson is going to be in charge for the night, but Lee, as we would see later on, he was really only sitting there as Ric Flair's puppet.
Mm-hmm.
What did you think about the amount of Charles we got on this show?
Way too much Charles. Just like the UK at the moment, there's just too much Charles.
Too much Charles. We were at peak Charles. Nice surprise, though, as we go to ringside. And our commentators for tonight are Tony and Mike today.
Yeah, good surprise to only have those two on commentary only.
Yeah, shame not to see Bobby, but you got no Larry... No,
Dusty, thank God, which we thought we were going to get.
Yes, I was fully sure we were going to get Dusty on this show, so that was a relief. And then, instead of like going to in-ring action after a live skit, a backstage skit, an introduction, and the Nitro Girls, we get a Piper in-ring promo. And I could see from... you tweeting during watching this, Lee, mm-hmm. that it really bugged you that this is very much like Reign of Terror Triple H era Raw, in as much as how the fuck long are we going to go before we get some wrestling on this?
Yeah, I think I timed it out like Piper's the first one into the ring 9 minutes into the show, and then he just cuts promo. Like I knew he wasn't going to be wrestling, but it's just like, come on, like you're supposedly in the hottest time period in your history, and you're starting the show with a visit to the insane asylum, a recap video, fucking the commentators on screen, the new president on screen, and then you get the Nitro Girls, And then you get Piper and Ray. It's like, oh, fucking hell, like, come on.
You can tell by the content of the promo that they really wanted to plug what was coming up on the show to keep people tuned in.
Mm.
So I can't understand how, if you were so desperate to keep people during the uncontested first hour, why you couldn't have done all this in half the time or save the first Flair segment until after you've announced the title match. Like, do the title match as the open. Mm-hmm. And then go to Flair if you must. Obviously, you know, with the book, we wouldn't have done Flair in the Asylum at all. But yes. Like, if you're just trying to, if you're going right, they've committed to doing this, then just do it after you've. Here's the actual reason to tune in, and now here's this horseshit. Is definitely the way I would have done it. There's a sign on the way to the ring, harsh, that says DDP fears soap. In spite of the fact that this video, we had just seen the Charles Robinson video package, and it had been played to the entire arena full of people, and Roddy Piper had surely overheard it, he insists that he's the only man in charge now that Flair is incapacitated. So if you heard any sort of audible groan from the audience immediately, because in the space of 90 seconds they were told two different people were the only person in charge. Oh. It just reminds me very much of Larry the other week, like, not knowing who was in charge. And now it's like one of the people has been taken out of the picture and somehow it's less clear.
Yeah, and don't forget, we are yet to see Eric Bischoff on the show, which we will later on. So,
yes.
And also, JJ still has some power.
Yeah. Even though Piper says he has power, but apparently doesn't, he manages to officially reinstate Randy Savage in WCW and put him against Scott Steiner for the US title tonight. Just as he's about to get round to world champion DDP, Paige comes out. He says that Paige is a man, like, he really bigs up Paige on the way to the ring as, like, a man who came from nothing. He's the world champion now. He's a man who says he'll defend the title against everyone. He says, well, if that's true, why not give a title shot to Sting? And as soon as he says Sting, the crowd go crazy. Paige says there's nothing he'd rather do than put it up against Sting tonight, but then changes his mind and says, I don't think so. And Piper reminds him that he is the boss, and I'm not asking you, I'm telling you, and you're defending it at the top of the hour.
Which he says, so like, he says 45 minutes from now, which will tell you how long into the show we are.
Yes. And I think he was being a bit like, he was definitely rounding when he said 45 minutes, because mm-hmm. we were past a quarter hour at this stage.
Easily.
And then, as if we hadn't been made to suffer enough, it was to be Bryan Adams versus Conan in the opening contest.
Now, if I'm after putting out 20 minutes of non-wrestling to open a show, when I come back from a break and I want to open a match, Dave...
Mm.
I don't know that I'm putting out 1999 Bryan Adams and Conan.
You could try and play devil's advocate here, Lee, and say, well, at least, like, Conan is over. So there is that. But yeah, against Bryan Adams is fairly inexcusable. I'm sure you were really giddy to learn that we'd be getting even more updates on Hogan's injury tonight. They are fucking milking this injury. Like, this, if you thought that the Triple H updates when he blew out his quad were excessive, you people have seen nothing. Because at least with Triple H, it's like, well, here's how his rehab is going this week, or here's a hype mm-hmm. video package about, like, how much he's pushing his body to the limit to get back to WWF. Every time we've got an update on Hogan, it's been variations on the same amount of information. The only difference this time is that we actually physically see Hulk and the Doctor this time. But we learn nothing.
No, like, literally, the fucking R&M videos were so much better than this.
Oh, 100%.
And half as irritating.
Yes. Well, you know, he needed to thank that sexy flight attendant who got him an extra pillow for his arm.
I was just going to say, half as irritating, and Randy Orton still came back as the biggest heel in the business.
How do I not remember salient details about my own job, but I remember that flight attendant in that R&N skit was called Sherry? Like, why do I remember that? It's been 20 years since that Survivor Series this month.
You really need to question your life choices, Dev.
I really do. It's a great Survivor Series, though.
Great year.
2002.
Or 2002, sorry. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Elimination Chamber.
Yes. That was a great Survivor Series.
Yeah.
Ah, fucking 2002. What a year.
Yeah. The one segment in which it seemed like Scott Steiner was going to be pretty cool in WWF when he came out and just destroyed Matt Hardy and Chris Nowinski.
Give me the fucking mic.
Yeah. Great stuff. Great stuff.
You know what wasn't great, Dave? Brian Adams and Conan.
Do you know what was super not great, Lee, was the sound mixing on Conan's entrance.
Mm-hmm.
Holy shit. There was a few entrances tonight where it's like they really like the commentary was way down too low and the music was way too high. They reminded us that last week Conan was jumped and taken out of a US title match by the NWO, allegedly at Kevin Nash's orders, but Kevin Nash denied sending them. He said he knew nothing about it. Conan looking to finish this match quick with a lot of big moves, but Adam cuts off a big back body drop attempt by elbowing Conan in the back of the head and throws him outside the ring. And yes, what proceeds is mostly a kick punch special outside the ring. Back in, press slam into a gut buster, which looked pretty decent, to be fair. Conan manages to... Conan, like, I love when Conan is like, I am not fucked doing a fiery babyface comeback. My comeback will be one kick to the gut and a face buster, and I'm going straight for my finish then.
I enjoyed the face buster because Brian Adams made Mayor Kane very proud with his knee bump.
He sure did. It's down onto the knees. Just as he goes to lock in the Tequila Sunrise, Stevie Ray and the NWO are in to beat him down. You've seen that story before.
More NWO black and white.
Yes. Next we get one vignette I'll never get sick of, no matter how many times they play it, and that's the Sting Crow vignette with the theme music. Play that every Nitro ever. I don't care.
Such an unexpected highlight.
Yes. Yeah,
and what followed was another unexpected highlight as Tony Schiavone is on screen in his leather jacket.
Yes, he did. Tony, cool dad Tony Schiavone is here to hammer home that the title match is happening at the top of the hour. Like, they really, really are like, don't change the channel. Please, please, please don't change the channel. And they say, apparently the next match was intended as a tag team match, but the Horsemen took out Perry Saturn and Kidman ahead of the three-way tag at the pay-per-view.
Mm-hmm.
So this next match will be presented as a handicap match, and that is Raven versus the Armstrongs. The Armstrongs in this case being Scott and Steve. And the Armstrongs are very pumped to be back on Nitro. They shout down the camera about being back. Raven doesn't seem too fussed, too stressed about facing the Armstrongs. And he's dead rightly, because have two wrestlers ever looked like more bumbling idiots than the Armstrongs in this match?
That's exactly what I have them described as in my notes. Bumbling, idiotic heels.
Tell the listeners what were the Armstrongs doing during this?
Like, it was almost like full on Three Stooges running into each other, hitting each other, like just
nearly fighting each other.
Yeah, just the most idiotic looking fucking guys. I'd never want to see an Armstrong on television again.
No, and there was a while where I was like, do you know what? Like, Brad isn't that bad.
Yeah, but like, I don't, listen, not my Brad.
It's these two.
It's these two and the other one.
Don't know who you mean. Do you know what would have been great?
Well, listen, we all know contracts aren't a problem for BG.
Do you know what I would have absolutely loved on Nitro? Raven versus Bullet Bob.
Yeah, didn't we get that in TNA?
We got Bullet Bob, fucking salty old fuck for ages in TNA, I believe.
I'm pretty sure we got Bullet Bob versus Conan versus Billy Gunn.
I think we got
a Raven match as well.
Good.
Gareth can correct us when he listens to this on his 3 a.m. walks.
Gareth can let us know. Yeah. he would like to register for the record, by the way, that he is not a fan of the Harris brothers.
I don't believe
it. He wanted it noted very publicly that he's not a fan of them, in spite of what you specifically inferred about him.
I have been told by Liam that Gareth is very excited for creative control to appear on our shows.
Good Lord. You and Liam have some sort of like backroom deal where you're trying to make him come off like a fascist.
Not at all.
No.
It's okay if he likes the Harris Brothers.
And has the same tattoo artist.
No, that's slander. That's you saying that?
Is it, yeah?
Garrett, I just want it on record, I did not say that.
He's holding up a sign that says it.
Hey, the Armstrongs are really shit.
Yeah, this, like, it was 3 to 5 minutes of the two of them accidentally attacking each other repeatedly, and Raven
just beating them up.
Just beating them up. Double bulldogs, arm drags, drop toe holds, both of them.
Raven looks like the coolest guy in the world. He's just beating up two guys very easily.
Yeah. He walks into a super kick from Scott at one stage, but then ducks a second one.
Super kick is very generous.
Yes, which then kicks Steve. Raven effect on Scott, and Steve belts Raven with a chair in the back of the head, and pulls Scott on top. And it was one of those surprise wins where it felt like no one cared, because it's like the story of the match isn't,
I cared.
Like, is it? Well, yeah, in a negative way, but I mean, like, no one popped because it wasn't like valiant underdog performance beating the bigger star. It's like these two guys are fucking idiots. That's the only, it didn't matter who won or lost. It's like, we now have established the two thickest wrestlers on this roster.
Do you know what these two fucking idiots should have been?
What?
They should have been the Patterson and Briscoe of WCW.
They wanted to be the Stooges so bad.
Yeah.
Like, they wanted that kind of actor, like, obviously J&J Security years and years later. Like, they could never be in the pantheon of great, like, stooge foils for a heel. Try as they might.
You think Scott Armstrong could pull off the Jerry Briscoe of Mr. Russo?
Mr. Russo. Possibly. We get our first Flair barking instructions at Charles from the Asylum. What do you think about the new presidential seal where they've just, like, smacked the new WCW logo on it in the background in Charles Robinson's office?
Very professional.
Very professional. Very not printed at a Xerox, like, earlier that day.
Listen, it's 1999 WCW. These things happen.
Flair just says he wants Piper in jail for what he said earlier. Fine. Then we get the same replay of the same Flair video package that we mentioned earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Next up, we got Gene in the ring with Robinson, who, as well as power over the company, apparently has power of attorney. So, like, I guess he gets to switch off the machines if Flair's in a coma. I don't know what that adds to this angle, but that's just knowledge that's out there now.
Let's hope he still has it.
And to undercut his own authority straight away, he's like, you know what? I am in charge here, but I guess you can have the title match that the other man made up earlier. Piper comes out again. Robinson calls for security. Piper calls him a little leprechaun and says, I can eat bowls of soup off your head.
I don't know what that means.
I don't know, but it made me laugh. He says the only thing he's in charge of is Flair's bedpan. Robinson says he has something from Rick and slaps Piper in the face, which is a bad idea. Security just manages to get out as he goozles Robinson. Piper is arrested and Robinson tries to do the Flair stripping freak out, saying he's in charge.
Yeah, he does the whole thing saying Piper's fired, but he still has to face Flair.
This was like, do you think it was Charles Robinson's birthday and as his present, Flair got him, okay, you can pretend to be me on TV for the night?
Maybe, yeah, possibly. It's a good show.
Yeah, because, like, this is clearly, like...
Well, I mean, they refer to him as Little Nate on the show.
Yeah, like, if I didn't know, like, if he wasn't still a referee now, I'd be like, the way they're letting him live out his Flair fantasy, I'm like, is he dying?
Do you know what I think it is?
What?
They've introduced David Flair on TV, and they feel really bad for Rick.
They need to make his other son.
So they're like, better. You know what? We're going to let you refer to Charles as your actual son.
Yeah.
So he can be the real Little Nate, and you can just ignore that David ever existed.
Let's put your fake son over huge. Because the other guy's such a formless idiot.
It's Ric Flair, so there's at least a 10% chance that Charles Robinson is actually his son.
Yeah. I was actually only thinking about this the other day because... what was I listening to? Thunder Riot. Oh, yeah. Deadlock. The Deadlock podcast did a look back at a 2000 episode of Thunder. And I only listened to the intro because I don't like listening to things that cover stuff we're going to cover because I don't want to end up aping their points when we eventually get to it. But they were talking about basically like it made me realize that maybe David Flair did have a bit of his dad in him because like he's a guy who got himself booked in an angle where Tori Wilson was his missus. And then in real life, he was actually dating Stacey Keibler when they were doing their storyline in 2000. So, like, you know, it's like maybe there is some flair in him after all. Next up. Lee's gone.
No, I'm not saying anything. No.
You're not touching that. No. Next up, we've got the WCW World Heavyweight Title match, Diamond Dallas Page versus Sting. And Lee, this was fabulous.
I don't think I loved it as much as you. It was a very good match. I
thought this match ruled. I went to look up what other people thought of it at the time. It's one of the highest rated matches of DDP's career. It's one of the highest rated Nitro matches. Big Dave himself gave it 4 stars in the Observer, which has to be one of the highest rated Nitro matches in the Observer.
I'd probably go about 4 stars. I thought it was very, very good.
I thought, like, it's kind of standard big match, big WCW title match stuff for the first half. And I thought when it starts going towards that finishing sequence, it's, oh my God, it was breathless. What did you think about the slight change, the 2 slight changes to Sting's gear? That being his little chain and his little white boots.
Okay, first of all, they're not white boots. It's athletic tape taped around his boots.
Ah, okay. I was watching on a smaller screen, so it looked like he was wearing kind of white boots.
No, it's athletic tape taped around his boots, and I can't figure out why, because if you were on a bigger screen, you might notice this. His tights were actually rolled up. So at the top of the athletic tape, you just see a little roll of his trousers.
Weird.
And it's very odd. I don't like it.
Do you think there was like, do you think maybe like, there was a problem with his laces or something?
I don't know. Like
that, like maybe his Mrs. Sting shrunk his gear in the wash and he had to tape it down to stop it from riding up on him.
I don't know. I can't figure it out. I don't like it. I think if he just had normal white boots, I think it'd look really cool.
Yeah, because that's what I thought. I was like, it's actually a pretty badass idea.
Yeah.
And I was wondering why I never noticed him do it. Like, it wasn't a variation of the gear I was familiar with, and obviously this is why something happened that made him have to do this for one night, possibly ever. What about his harkening back to his surfer days with his little chain though?
It's a nice little addition.
He's looking in great shape.
He really
though,
is though. Yeah, I have to say,
lean and fucking cut.
And this, when I think of like WCW Sting, this is the era of Sting. So
yeah.
I don't know if the face paint is slightly different.
It is. So this is when, compared to if you look at him side by side with Starrcade 97, like it's where the lines get more pronounced, the black lines get more pronounced and thick, and it's more akin to the Sting face paint we all think of when we think of Sting now.
All that's missing now is the little schmig down the middle, and that has to be an Irish thing, isn't it, referring to it as a schmig?
Oh yeah, because I think that actually is Irish, I think.
For anyone that's not aware, that it's the little goatee thing that does be on his face paint,
his little soul patch.
Yes, soul patch.
I thought you were going to say, for those of you who don't know, we're Irish. Like, I think that's been fairly well fucking rattled at this point, Lee. The secret is out.
I will say, I think this is the type of match we never, not that we never, that we rarely get on either Nitro or the pay-per-views, where it's just a straight up match between two of the main eventers with a clean finish. And, like, we could probably name the other ones off the top of our head. You have Goldberg Hogan, which had interference. You have Goldberg DDP, which they really fucked up. You had Goldberg Sting, which I have to say, Sting seems to be the common denominator here, because that just had a clean finish.
Yeah.
Like, there you go. That's a three I can think of off the top of my head. This, I think, was absolutely... I think if this closed out the show... This would have been a lot more of a memorable show.
Yeah. Yeah, 100%. Like, I think they... I think this would be a lot more... I was wondering why this isn't spoken about more. And I think it's because they basically undercut everything this match achieves about an hour and a half later.
Mm.
You know? Like, in isolation, if you just dropped somebody in, showed them this match, didn't tell them what happened on the rest of Nitro, they'd be like, that is one of the great TV title matches of the era, surely. But then, yeah, later on happens. But we'll get to that. Let's just enjoy this while we're here, Lee. So, Paige takes a powder outside early. Then he gets back in the ring. They stand face-to-face slugging. I'll tell you what, I do love this. So, it's like DDP tries to razzle him, and he has to go outside and take a breather. Then he goes inside, and he's like, right, fuck this. And I love the big match feel when the crowd is hot and the guys just start throwing bombs. And they're doing this at the start. And again, Paige can't live with it, and he ends up going to the outside again. And the story very early on is that newly found heel Paige is struggling and to come to terms with the fact that he can't live with Sting's offense.
I was just going to say, he can't get the better of Sting. Like, this is him against a real, in a one-on-one match with a real main eventer. Yeah. And you're seeing DDP kind of struggle to adapt. It's... It's really good at the start. I think it's early on, like very early, like one of the opening salvos of the match. DDP throws a big right hand, and Sting just no sells it.
Yeah,
and the crowd like pop for it.
There's a moment of like introspection on Paige's face when he takes the second breather. That is like the, have I overestimated myself or underestimated Sting?
Mm-hmm.
Where he's like, I might actually be in trouble here. And I love those little bits of doubt that get sewn into Paige's game, because like Paige is a guy who's all about preparation and about confidence. Like, this is since time immemorial on the show, we've been talking about it. Like, he gets bigged up all the time as such a great student of the game. And what a lot of this match asks that I really liked is, what happens when all your plans are failing?
Mm.
And all your weapons, because we'll talk about it when we get to the diamond cutter attempts. I was like, what happens when your opponent has studied you as well as you've studied them, and you can't hit the move that kills everyone? So Paige back in with some brief offense, but then a really early stinger splash and deathlock attempt, and Paige is forced to go scrambling to the rope. And has to go outside a third time to go get a drink. And he's like, I nearly lost the world title in 5 minutes. Like, is that like, I need to calm the fuck down here?
Yeah, like, you know that thing we've talked about with Billy Kidman, where the fans, as soon as he goes to the rope for the 7 year itch to shoot and start press, like, they're up and anticipating it because it's such a hot move.
Yeah.
After the stinger splash into the scorpion deadlock, the fans are like, like, they're up, they're anticipating it, they're ready for it. They think Sting's about to win the world title. And like you say, when Paige gets to the ropes, it's like, there's that audible kind of,
We get, Paige then tries, like, plan C or D at this point already. And does something that, I guess, in the context of the match where you're just like, this is something unexpected from Paige that kind of catches Sting off guard. He does a double leg takedown.
Mm.
And starts trying to like strike from the top at him. But Sting fights back to his feet, back and forth. DDP lays him out with a clothesline, but he gets back up. And then we get our first diamond cutter attempt, but Sting is like, nah, and throws DDP out of the ring. And now DDP is not only in disbelief, but he's tried the Diamond Cutter once, it didn't happen, and now he's angry. So they start brawling in the aisle because Paige is like, fuck this, I'm already sick of this. They go back to the ring and Sting gets dropped on the turnbuckle, which gives Paige an opening. Belly to back, and it looks like DDP finally has control of the match, which causes the crowd to start booing. Sting really digs deep as Paige is dominant here and headbutts Paige quite low as a receipt for Paige striking him quite low earlier in the match. The ref admonishes Paige, which makes him quite mad, and shoves him a little, at which point the commentary tries to keep consistency and say, well, he's going to be fine for that. So he does, the bit where he kind of has Sting down and he's rubbing his elbow like into his eye socket, which looks like it wrecks, and he's taken off the paint, and it's always a cool look when like Sting's been through a war and the face paint is crumbled and just wiped away.
Splotches of paint left on his face at the end. It's really cool.
It's deadly. Stomps and he starts trash talking Sting because now he's starting to feel his oats a little bit. Sting in desperation starts throwing bombs at Paige, but he eats a neck breaker. DDP then, he tries to crotch Sting on the ring post. It doesn't work, so he wraps his leg around it a couple of times before Sting, out of desperation again, shoves Paige back with his legs into the barricade. He's back in. This is where it starts really going up again, because he goes for the Diamond Cutter again, and Sting holds on to the top rope but goes down to his knee. So there's a moment where everyone's like, oh fuck, did he get him? But now Sting is fine. He's okay. I thought that was really good, rather than just like hold on, because I think that would have, there's a spot later where he does just hold on, and I think if he had done the hold on thing the same way twice, people would have like not popped as much the second time.
The first one sets up the, it's like table setting for the second one, for the finish, like.
So like I'm already starting to go like, I can't remember the last big Paige match I've seen where someone blocks two Diamond Cutters successfully. So like, and the crowd, you're starting to feel the crowd go, fuck, like he can't do it. So he lands top rope to avoid, hits a jawbreaker on Paige, punches, inverted atomic drop, bulldog. The crowd are starting to think that it's going to happen. He goes up top, hits the big splash off the top rope for a two count. Paige brings it back outside the ring where he can't be pinned for more brawling. And like the intensity level on this brawling now is kicking up because like both of them are pissed. Another Sting comeback. He rams this. Oh, this was great. Ramming Paige's head into all three turnbuckles. It's like 1, 2, 3, yeah. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. It's really good. The crowd loved it as well. Big sit out powerbomb from Paige for a two count. And like right after that, Sting nearly rolls him up, but gets absolutely murdered by a lariat. And then Sting hits. I screamed at this pile driver.
Terrified. I was absolutely terrified watching it.
He goes for like what looks like it's going to be a gotch style pile driver, and then goes down to his knees instead of sitting out. It was like Paige had died. I was like, I could not believe it. It was great.
The margin for error on that is like fucking minimal.
Yeah. So then after that two count, he goes to pile drive him again. Tombstone variation this time. Paige reverses. It gets reversed again. Sting hits him with the tombstone and Paige kicks out. Sting goes for a hip toss, float over DDT from Paige. He then tries a backslide attempt, Sting does, but Paige mule kicks him in the balls, and everyone's like, oh, okay, this is it, because like he goes to mule kick him, and he backs up into the corner, just in perfect position for the Diamond Cutter. He goes for the cutter, Sting holds on, lifts his head, grabs him, Scorpion Death Drop, and wins. Awesome.
Yeah, I have to say, it's one of the best, most creative finishes ever on Nitro, I think. The way Sting, like you say, it's perfectly timed. They back up into the corner. Paige hooks the cutter And Sting, it's, I think it's the left arm.
Yeah.
No, it's the right arm. He hooks into the rope, and he catches, like, it's all, it's like so fluid. And then he hooks the head for the DDT.
The whole thing is encapsulated really well by, if you watch the slow motion replay, there's a guy in like the second row on the angle they do the replay from, who's like, when it looks like Paige is about to get the cutter, he's like, oh shit. And then you can see him as it starts to dawn on him that Sting held on. He's like, oh. And then when he gets him for the deadlock, he's like, or the death drop, he's like, ah!
Yeah.
And then when the three count, you can see like him jumping up and down. Yeah, it's really good. That's what it is. He got him.
I love, especially the, like I say, he hooks the top rope. And he walks out. He doesn't just hit the DDT. He walks out from the ropes. Mm-hmm. It's that thing of like, Sting is thinking here. He knows he has him.
Yeah.
And he doesn't want to give him the easy option of grabbing the rope or getting a rope break.
You've left yourself exposed here, so that I've got you.
And do you know what it is? Yeah. It's DDP, the king of the flash finish, hitting the cutter out of nowhere. He got caught himself.
Yeah. It's just great, simple pro wrestling storytelling and just a great world title.
Like for what, 2 years, it's been nobody.
Yeah.
What, the cutter can come out of nowhere and nobody blocks it. And like you said, the whole match is Sting avoiding it and DDP getting too clever, going for it too often, and Sting cut him.
Yeah. It was just so fucking good. And one of those, again, it's only sparingly we'll say this about any of the TV shows, but go back and watch this. From Nitro 189. Just this match. It's so fucking good. My friends, you hate to see it. You work all day in a thankless job at the stuff factory. Then you get home. It's late at night. It's cold. It's wet. It's tiring. It's tiring. And the last thing you want to do is start cooking, start chopping, start preheating ovens, all this kind of absolute nonsense. You're going to end up ordering high calorie food just for the convenience of it being brought to your door, or you're going to end up, saddest of all, having a bowl of cereal over the sink while you have an existential crisis about the life choices that led you there. You could just make it more simple, my friends, because I'm here to tell you about HelloFresh. With HelloFresh, you get farm-fresh, pre-portioned ingredients and seasonal recipes delivered right to your doorstep. Skip trips to the grocery store and count on HelloFresh to make home cooking easy, fun, and affordable. That's why it's America's number one meal kit. Subscribe to HelloFresh and check Save Money off your fall to-do list. HelloFresh is 25% cheaper than takeout and less expensive than grocery shopping, too. It's time to cozy up and save money by cooking at home. Fall is the perfect time to experience the delicious taste and unparalleled convenience of HelloFresh. Have your pumpkin spice and eat it too with a rotating selection of fall-inspired items from HelloFresh Market. From brunch kits to a fall dessert board, you'll find everything you need for all your favorite autumn occasions like tailgating, Oktoberfest, and more. To avail of this offer being made to the Days of Thunder listener, please go to HelloFresh.com/VOW65 and use code VOW65 for 65% off plus free shipping. That's HelloFresh.com/VOW65. Use the code VOW65 at checkout. HelloFresh, America's number one meal kit. Unfortunately, we go from the sublime straight to the ridiculous. We're back in the mental hospital. And Flair wants Charles to make Goldberg versus Sting at Slamboree, which, look,
why?
You know what, Rick? That would be cool. I'm down with it. Like, it makes no sense why he would want that, but I'm here for it. I totally more understand why Flair says what he said later, where he wants all four men basically to destroy each other, because what we're supposed to be thinking, because the Flair character is that he wants the world title back. So why is he signing all these matches that he's not in? So a multiple man match so that like they all pick each other off makes more sense than him saying, oh, the pay-per-view should be two completely different guys, neither of which I can probably beat. Anyway, we then get another title match on the show, and that's a Cruiserweight title match, Psicosis versus Rey Mysterio Jr. I like the nice touch during the entrances that Psicosis had used his horns to pierce his rally towel.
Well, I was going to say, do you think he used his horns, or did he cut out the holes on his towel?
Oh, like, no.
Do you think he measured out the holes on the towel? And
he definitely cut it, because, like, obviously, you know, they're lovely soft horns. But the effect was great. I really like it. Again, it's one of those, Lee, where we could try as we might to type out all the spots as they happen and go play by play, but it's very hard to do that.
It is. I always enjoy when we get Psicosis versus Ray. It's just always a nice match.
Yeah, there was a scary little moment where, off a head scissors, Psicosis absolutely snotted Ray off the middle rope.
Hmm.
I thought you could very easily have gotten pretty fucked up on that.
Do you know one thing I've noticed?
What's that?
When Ray is in there with somebody he trusts, especially at this time, he moves like he's like a half step quicker.
Yeah.
It's like if you watch him in there with Ray, or with Psicosis, you watch him in there with Jericho, you watch him in with Benoit Malenko, he just moves. He's like gone. But if you watch him in there with somebody a little bit less experienced who he's not quite sure, he really slows it down.
Yeah, he's like, when he's in with people he really trusts, and he's like, I know this person knows what I'm going to do and will be there to like catch me or base for me or, you know, do whatever. That's when you see the real, like the real crazy Ray.
Like, I really like the Kidman matches. I think he has very good chemistry with Kidman. But I think even with Kidman, he takes it down a little.
Especially
when you compare it to like when he's in there with Psicosis, but in particular.
Yeah, he's like maybe drops one gear.
Mm-hmm.
You know? But yeah, this is all really good. Apart from there's one, Ray goes to do his apron Hurricane Rana and they mistimed it. It was very awkward.
God, Psicosis was lucky. He, like, obviously Ray's doing the Rana from the top rope off the apron to the floor. And I don't know whether it was Ray mistimed it, whether Hoovy wasn't set. I don't know what, or I said Hoovy, where the Psicosis wasn't set. But Psicosis just does not go for the bump at all. He kind of thinks about it and stops, and thankfully he did, because I don't think he would have rotated fully and it could have been very, very nasty.
Yeah, no, it could have been trouble.
One thing I did like about this match is that Psicosis does not take any disgusting bumps.
No, he doesn't.
Thank God for his tailbone.
Yes, you were fully expecting like the guillotine leg drop to the floor or something like that, but it never comes in this match. But what does come out is Dean and Benoit, after the awkward Hurricane Rana, they're posing outside with Ray's belt, but he takes them out with a double bulldog before Psicosis baseball slides the belt into Ray's face. This is something I hadn't mentioned yet about the commentary on this. Tony and Mike Tenay, dirty old feckers on this show.
Oh, what did they say?
Because the amount of times they were like, we're going to have a Gorgeous George training video later on in the program. You're going to want to stay tuned for that. This is already, we're like three matches in, aren't we? Mm-hmm. And four matches in, and we have had maybe five plugs for this Gorgeous George video, and it's very much like all of it is with the tone of like like rubbing their thighs, something for the dads.
I mean, listen, it's 1999.
They're red blooded men drinking their Surge.
Fucking Surge. Surge is all over this show, and it's not even DNA.
Oh my god, Surge has bought time on this show, surely.
Look, I'm not going to knock them advertising. Listen, when you compare what was happening on Raw, them plugging a Gorgeous George training video, not the worst.
I was going to say, they also, I guess, know their audience in 99.
Yeah.
So, Psicosis signals for the end of the match, goes for a powerbomb, it's reversed into a DDT, and Ray wins. So he's got his title back, but he doesn't get time to celebrate because the horsemen jump him. and they dispose of Psychosis. The end of the beating comes when it's not like some great big wrestling move. It's not like a crossface, a diving headbutt, a cloverleaf. So the two of them just grab him and fucking yeet him into low Earth orbit and let him hit the ground. So Ray's the new champion, but at what cost, Lee?
Not much. I mean, he just got beat up. Like,
thanks, pal. I tried to fucking yes and you, and you're like, nah.
What cost? He got beaten up. His partner has already been hospitalized. He's very lucky that he even got to have a match.
I think you just didn't follow on there because you were excited that the next thing was a vignette to let you know that Brian Knobbs was going to be in a fatal four-way hardcore match later. And I know this of you because you are, as we established last week, the number one knob. This is what they say. Oh, I'm leaving this dead air in, pal. You can no sell me for as long as you want. He's just shaking the head.
I'm no selling you just as much as Brian Knobbs no sold every bit of fucking offense on, in this match that comes up later on. Fucking Brian Knobbs. Fucking Hogan's not even daring his fucking mates all over the show.
Big Sexy is here, speaking of Hogan's mates. He said he's just heard about the title match for Slamboree, and everyone forgot that he has a title shot that he earned.
No, they didn't.
he said everybody did, Lee, and who am I to doubt him? He said, well, seeing as Goldberg, Page, and Sting are also here, he's throwing open the challenge to all four of them. Four-way dance, title on the line. I just thought, like, I guess we're doing the thing now where Nash is a babyface, so he's valiantly taking on all comers in this title match. But like,
why did he just go, well, everyone forgot how I have a title match, so I want Sting tonight.
Yeah, like, surely it's like, get in line behind me. That's the logical thing you do, but you know, whatever. So then we get Flair again in the funny farm. He's delighted with the idea of the four-way. He said to Charles, you need to make it official. And then he encourages the nurse to climb on Space Mountain with him. And this, as you said, marked a debut.
Of Asia.
Yes.
Asia, who's larger than China.
Yeah. Do you have any... to introduce the listeners to Asia... Do you have anything? Do you have any pre-prepared thoughts, feelings?
No. I mean, look, she was a female bodybuilder that was hired because China was really hot in the WWF at the time.
Asia spelled A-S-Y-A, by the way.
Yes, yes. Because China was spelled with a Y.
Yes. Thunder trivia for you. Days of Thunder trivia. Who is Asia married to and has happily been married to for 22 years?
Is it another wrestler?
It is.
Is it another WCW wrestler?
It is.
I don't know.
Oh, she's married to one Dale Torborg.
Get the fuck out of here.
There you go. Yeah. That one's for you, pal. You could take that home.
Those two could be booked on the indies as like a tag team these days.
They absolutely could. Oh, they would clean up. Clean up, they would. You talk about, like, you get them as a tandem, like in one of the fucking Janela Spring Break shows.
Imagine them against, like, Bussy or...
Yeah. Any one of them meme teams. What have we got up next? So, oh, yes. We have Bam Bam Bigelow versus Eric Watts.
I love this match. I love this. This was great.
Because it was like 90 seconds long.
First of all, Eric Watts is always a good time.
Is he?
Yes.
I'll tell you what. I know who didn't agree with you. And that was Fargo, North Dakota tonight.
Listen. Just like the Raw crowd last night. These fans had no idea what good wrestling is. Eric Watts is always over. It's not his fault that the crowd didn't react. I mean, acting like it's me, EM, coming out here.
They had... What is this bit? What are you doing?
Have you not seen the online discourse from all the Fed apologists that it's the fans' fault that Raw was so bad?
Yeah, I saw something about it, but yeah. I thankfully haven't been online enough today.
It's the fans' fault. That's all you need to know. Eric Watts is good. That's going to be my parting shot here.
Okay, he hits the worst Hurricane Rana I have ever seen in my life. Was it a Hurricane Rana or a head scissors he tries to do? He tries to do something of this description.
He does a springboard bulldog, a stratisfaction, if you will, out of the corner and lands on Bam Bam's face.
Is that what he was doing?
Yes.
Oh, Lee. Now, that's what he was trying to do.
I need to ask the question of why you would have a 6'8" or whatever the fucking height he is, Eric Watts do a springboard bulldog out of the corner.
It was so bad. It kind of worked with the match because it was so bad that Bam Bam got up and was so embarrassed that he just gave him the greetings from Asbury Park and pinned him.
He instantly beat him up.
It's like, I no longer wish to be part of this match. Good night.
I think he literally gets up from it, yeah. Puts Watts on his ass, flying headbutt, gets up, greetings, that's it. It's brilliant. I genuinely really enjoyed this match.
To each their own, I guess. Sting is on the ramp next with Gene to give his answer. His paint has been meticulously reapplied in the 3 or 4 segments since the title match. What a pro. He accepts so that there will be no more whining in the back once he wins tonight. And the one thing that kind of disappointed me about this, Lee, was why did he not bring out the belt?
Yeah, why didn't he have the belt?
Like, if this is legit and I win a world title, you would have to take that thing out of my cold, dead hands. I'd be so happy. He didn't even bother bringing it with him.
To be fair, he repainted. Yeah, maybe he was busy doing his paint and they were like, oh, Sting, you're up. And he just didn't have the belt with him.
We get a world television title match next, which is Booker T versus Meng. And we get on the way to the ring, as Booker's coming out, we see a sign plugging Lords of Pain.
Hell yeah.
Which made me laugh. Booker looks so happy coming to the ring. Like, what a baby face. He's just so happy to be here. High-fiving everybody. But it's all Meng at the start of this.
It is, but I have to say, Meng gives Booker a lot. Like, Meng...
For Meng, yeah. On the Meng scale, like, he was bumping.
Yeah, he really was in a big bumping mood. Meng's not someone we've seen being easily dispatched of in our run.
Yeah.
And Booker pretty handily kind of deals with him.
Yeah, flying forearm, drop kick, good offense. But then he does the sidekick, and when he does it, Meng bumps backwards. The ref gets hit. Stevie starts skulking down to the ring as Booker tries to wake the ref. Sidekick gets ducked. Death grip is in. And Stevie comes in and unexpectedly slapjacks Meng. And Booker wins. And just as I was trying to get into that, get over that confusion, Rick Steiner is here. And he attacks Stevie Ray, and then Booker pulls Rick Steiner off Stevie Ray without seemingly pausing to ask, why are either of you here?
Because I think the obvious answer is because Harlem Heat and Steiner just don't get along.
Yes.
Even in spite of the fact that two of them are part of WCW and two of them are part of NWO Black and White.
Yeah. It's an interesting one. It's an interesting one. We get a Nash vignette,
I was just going to say, here's what you've been waiting for all night.
Tony and his Surge.
Mm-hmm.
And they're here to throw to the Hogan update. Firstly, we get to see one of the rarest sights of nature. We actually get to see Dr. James Andrews.
I genuinely did not think he was a real person.
Yeah, I know. He's just one of those, I've heard his name for over 20 years of my life and never expected to see what he actually looks like.
I think he should have been one of them doctors on Grey's Anatomy that you just hear about all the time but is never on the show.
Yeah, absolutely. Or he's always masked up to right below the eyeballs, and then the cap comes down to right at the eyeballs, so you can't identify him.
You can never know if it's a different actor all the time.
Yeah, it could be Dr. Cecil Schwartz either, like, you never know. So he says that the injury that Hogan has is a torn meniscus, which I believe that's not the first nor the last time he has one of those injuries. Obviously, because this is WCW, he has to put the Hulkster over Strong Brother, saying that it's a miracle he could move or do anything the last few years. We see Hogan and Bischoff get out of the limo as he's dropping him off for surgery, and they're bickering over whether he should have the surgery or not. Hogan thinks he should focus on Paige, take Paige out first, win his title back, and then have the surgery. And Bischoff disagrees, and Hogan yields to that. There was really, like, it just, that just killed 30 seconds of time. Like, there was no sense of, like, storyline development or purpose to them doing that. It's like, oh, I don't want to do it. Yeah, well, you're going to do it, but I don't want to.
Well, see,
like, well, you're gonna.
What they were establishing was that Hulk Hogan can beat Diamond Dallas Page at any time he wants.
Yeah.
In spite of having a fucked up leg.
Mm.
And that really, Page is lucky that Hogan isn't going after him, because Bischoff is, you know, telling him to go get the surgery.
Next we get, and I do not say this lightly, the funniest thing Hogan has ever done. Apart from maybe there aren't Hulkamaniacs here. There aren't any Hulkamaniacs here. Did you notice the funny bit about this surgery?
No, go for it.
So Hogan gets wheeled in. He's anesthetized. And as they're doing the, like, as you'll often see with wrestler surgery videos, like, they're zooming in on, like, the face and, you know, the x-rays and the doctor's faces and stuff like this. And there is a single shot that shows Hogan's face while he's under for surgery. And the surgical cap he's got on, he wrote NWO on it. And I fucking wept. Your blue surgical cap, and he's taken a marker and written NWO on us.
Jesus
it
Christ.
Felt like one of those, like, if found, return to the New World Order labels.
You should have had your man do the voice and say, this surgery has been paid for by the NWO.
It was so funny that I'm 1,000% sure he didn't come up with it. Because he is not and has never been that intentionally funny.
Or he did it earnestly and just, you know, he, to be fair, he gets paid for every time he wears NWO merch on screen, so.
Yes, yes. They're saying it looks like he's going to be out for a while. I think we looked this up a couple of episodes ago and he's back by the summer.
Yeah.
So Flair back in the hospital. He demands that Booker versus Steiner happens at the pay-per-view, and the world title match is set to be no disqualification tonight. And then we get what I suppose is the quote-unquote payoff of this whole thing. Lee, would you like to explain what happens next?
No. What happens next is Rick proceeds to lead every patient in a Ric Flair kind of semi strut, you know, the slap on the shoulders, doing the little jiggle, and then you hear the ooh, ooh, and the camera pans out and there's a patient that isn't participating, as it turns out to be Scott Hall.
God.
And they all do the spooky fingers at Hall as he proceeds to throw his toothpick at Flair, and end scene.
Yeah.
If this wasn't directed by Tobias Funke, I don't know what to say.
We just needed Frightened Inmate number 2.
Yeah.
That's all it was missing. We got our Fatal 4-Way Hardcore match. It's Hack versus Horace versus Mikey Whipwreck versus Brian Knobbs.
I actually have another Arrested Development comparison to make here.
Go for it.
Do you know who Chastity was dressed as for this episode of Nitro?
No.
Charlize Theron.
Rita?
Rita, yeah.
Yeah.
With the backpack, God. And the white.
Yes, yes. Mr. F. Yeah. Yeah. Tremendous. I mean, this is just like, you know, it's not as good as the hardcore match from the other week that we praised, Opening Thunder. But, you know, there were some fun bits, like three of them being armed and then Hack decided he was going to take them all on and get absolutely murdered.
Yeah.
What else do we have? We had a running splash on Hack on the ladder. We come through a break and all of a sudden there is a surge bin in the ring.
No surge in it, though.
No surge in it. Which was and it didn't really play into anything. I thought, oh, right, the finish is going to include the surge bin now. It's going to be like the fucking Cracker Barrel thing in AEW that time. Not so much, though. Hack gets a table, sets it up between the apron and the rail, sets up another one on the opposite side of the floor, too. After a while, Horace is hitting Hack with a strap and Chastity sprays him with the fire extinguisher. Hack does his dive over the ropes on top of nothing but table as Horace moves out of the way. Hack then does a somersault off a ladder through Mikey and the table. Nobbs then squishes Hack with a trash can, drops a ladder on Mikey and wins. And I know the Nob Republic were absolutely delighted with this. The Nob Nation, should I say.
The Nob Nation, is that what we're being referred to now as?
Yes.
I watched this in disbelief as Brian Knobs sold nothing. He was needlessly fucking reckless.
Yes.
And I say this as somebody that genuinely doesn't care what wrestlers put themselves through because they have free will. But yes. This man, he was literally just fucking nailing people with things. Mm-hmm. And it was embarrassing. Fucking just awful shit. Like, why is Brian Knobs the first person that stops Chastity with the like he puts a trash can up in front of his face to stop the fire extinguisher? Why is Brian Knobs of all people the one to get the payoff of that?
Just why is Brian Knobs?
He then cuts a promo into the camera after he wins. Something about this is nasty.
I wrote it down.
Oh, did you?
I wrote it down. So that maybe a team of scientists could possibly decode it. He says that the gates of Nastyville are open, so to get ready for a taste of nasty sensation. And as he says that, Tony Schiavone responds with, okay. And then moves on to the next segment, which I think is all that promo deserved.
Do you think Tony Schiavone was sitting there just dazing off into the distance going, what's happening here?
Is one of those where a little bit of the joy he had left in his heart was taken out.
As Brian Knobs starts to get a push in 1999.
Yeah. We get the WCW United States Heavyweight title on the line. It's Scott Steiner versus Randy Savage. Steiner comes out first. He moans about how I don't take any orders from WCW, but he's going to do the match anyway because he likes the idea and that he insists on taking Savage's freak if he wins. So Savage comes out with Gorgeous George and the debuting on this podcast, Miss Madness.
Do they refer to Miss Madness at all in this match?
They do.
Oh, they do.
So
okay.
She has the Miss Madness sash and they're like, who is this woman? With him, I believe it says Miss Madness. And Miss Madness, for those of you who don't know, is the very familiar face of one Molly Holly.
Mm-hmm.
And it would take you like a couple of seconds of looking through the, because it's such a completely different look with all the makeup and the hair is up and
the beauty pageant kind of dress and
yes with the sash and all that, like it would take you a couple of seconds to recognize her, but it's her, all right. Robinson is out to ref this match in street clothes because of course he is. The two guys take ages to get going and I'm like, what the fuck is going to happen here? And then I learned very quickly they lock up in the corner. Steiner pushes Savage back. Savage brushes off Robinson and Robinson disqualifies him. Now, I hate the heel ref gimmick. Absolutely hate it. But this is one of the rare times where the logic wasn't broken. Because it was like literally the first opportunity he got to disqualify Savage, he did. So I cannot argue that it actually was a logical heel ref thing, but they just shouldn't have done it because it's terrible.
Yeah, don't promote a Scott Steiner Macho Man match at the top of the show to then not deliver.
in the semi-main.
Yeah.
So George is in and Robinson bails out of the ring to get away from her, but Medusa jumps him, marking her first appearance on the podcast. And George strips him down to reveal that he had the same boxers on as Flair. Ha ha ha.
Yeah, so this is the full introduction of Team Madness.
Yeah. I'm just so, so, so not looking forward to that pay-per-view match. But anyway, we'll get to that when we get to it. We do have the long-promised Gorgeous George training video. I wrote...
Do you have a scene-by-scene description of this video?
No, I wrote two words. Unbelievably porny.
I will say, I've been told that this is the Kevin Dunn's favourite thing WCW ever did.
I, for one, am not surprised by this. I think it was filmed in Sal Bandini's apartment from Ready to Rumble. And you will not tell me otherwise. Next up, it's main event time already. WCW World Heavyweight Title 4-way match. Sting versus DDP versus Kevin Nash versus Goldberg. You already knew things were bad because generally uber professional Sting comes out with the closest thing to boo-boo face I've ever seen him with. He was not happy to be here for this second match. Yeah.
Genuinely, I think this adds to my theory that this was not booked in advance.
Yeah. Because he did seem kind of happy when he won the title.
Yeah, like, you look at, like, the effort himself and Paige put into that match early in the show.
Yeah.
And then, like you say, he comes out with a lot less enthusiastic.
Yeah. Either they were rebooking and doing this stuff on the fly, or they just, also possibly, very possible for WCW, they didn't tell him that he was dropping the belt straight away. I would believe either.
Either is a very logical conclusion to come to concerning WCW.
Yeah. I don't have a lot written down about this match.
There's not much to write down. It's punch, kick, it's breaking up pins, and
for a match with like four of the biggest names in the company, for a world heavyweight title match, for a main event, it's a whole lot of nothing. Like, you have a lot of Paige early on is like sitting out in the crowd as the other three guys fight, and he slowly makes his way back, and then he gets in, and then they're all fighting.
And that's the other thing. It's unbalanced. There's three clear baby faces and one heel.
Yeah. Yeah. Everyone's getting in each other's way. It's clearly not very well planned out. Maybe that's why DDP was sitting outside, because he didn't know what the spots were. DDP gets speared as Sting puts Nash in a deathlock. Then a spear on Sting. Savage is out and breaks it up. Throws the brass knuckles in. And DDP hits the diamond cutter on Sting. KOs Nash and wins. And the crowd, big mad. Like, some people start celebrating because he runs through the crowd. Mm. And they're like, hey, Paige is here. But, like, on the whole, people were fucking pissed.
Yeah, so this is now the second time that Macho Man has helped DDP win the world title.
Yeah. And this is also the second, probably the third time since we've done this podcast where they made a good decision, give Sting the world heavyweight title, and then fucked him as quickly as they could.
Yeah. And I have to say, like, if you look at the reactions Sting is getting in that match early in the night against DDP, they absolutely still had something in Sting in 1999 with the fans.
In spite of everything they would do to Sting, he remained incredibly over until the day that company fucking died.
They still, in 2001, could have pushed this man as the face of WCW, and people were willing to accept it.
Yeah. And they come close many times, almost as a rib to the fans, I think. It's like, oh, you think we're going to do it? Nah.
I mean, look, TNA did it in fucking, what, 2006, 2007?
Yeah.
And fans accepted it.
Yeah. Fucking, I think if they did it in 2022 in AEW, a lot of fans would be like, yeah, fuck it. Like, man's still unbeaten in AEW.
Listen, you can't tell me you didn't get excited when you saw Muta and Sting in the same ring.
Oh, dude. Like, pretty much everything Sting has done since he's shown up, I'm hyped for. He went from a guy that, like, when he came to the company, I was just like, God, after, like, the Rollins match and, like, him breaking his neck, I'm just like, oh, I don't know if I ever want to see this guy again. And I do not think of that at all.
No.
When he wrestles now. I just want to see him do cool stuff and dive off shit like a mad bastard. Lee, that's the end of Nitro. What did you think of the show? Your overall thoughts and your winners and losers, if you please.
It, like I said at the top of the show, it was an easy show to watch. I hated a lot of stuff on it.
Mm-hmm.
But there was some good.
Yeah.
It very much epitomizes 1999 in that sense. Like, yeah. it perfectly encapsulates what WCW is. You can see some of the good stuff.
Yeah.
But my God, is it surrounded by a shower of shit.
You have to really pick through a lot of stuff that's somewhere between bad and just, like, time-wasting
mm-hmm.
to get to the real good stuff.
Like, you look at the people that weren't on this show
mm-hmm.
when you consider their roster. And then you look at, they had Ric Flair and Scott Hall appear in an insane asylum, basically.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They had Macho Man on the show.
Yeah.
Didn't do fuck all, like wrestling was.
They had him on the show twice.
Yes. Piper should not be anywhere near the show.
No. Nope.
At this point. And yeah, he's like in one of the fucking main storylines.
Mm-hmm.
And
one of the marquee matches at the next pay-per-view.
Yeah, and I think I am less enthused about the tag title feud now after mm-hmm. this one episode because they weren't on it at all. Like, yeah. The Ray is on it and the Horseman beat him up.
Yeah.
But there's nothing else there.
Yeah, and the other two lads were beaten up off camera.
Yeah, and the other guy got beat in a handicap match by jobbers.
Yeah. Yeah, so who are your biggest winners and losers out of that? Because it seems like there's a lot of losers.
There really is a lot of losers. I think Bam Bam looked cool, like squashing Eric Watts. Yeah. I think Booker, again, just looked good.
Yeah.
And I think Sting, like, fuck, like, man.
Sting, in spite of the decision of the main event, Sting looked like a megastar.
They still had something there with Sting. And... Yeah. Yeah, like, it's one of those things of you just look at it in hindsight and you go, like, how did they fuck it up?
Yeah. It was right there on a plate so many times with Sting.
Mm-hmm.
And they're just like, nah. Don't fancy it, lads.
Biggest losers. Sting. Which is a weird thing to say, but you know where I'm coming from with that one.
Mm-hmm.
I think Raven looks so shit losing to those two fucking jobbers.
Yeah.
Like, just loses so much steam.
Yeah. It did nothing for them and made him look like an idiot.
And
great job, WCW.
Yeah. And Scott Steiner feels very directionless at the moment. In spite of being US champ and being kind of more elevated than he has ever before.
Yeah. His role on the show now is I'm US champ and I'm real mad at stuff.
He just doesn't seem to be involved in anything of substance. Which is odd.
For the guy who, you know, theoretically has the number two belt.
Yeah, like at worst, he's the number two heel in the company right now.
Yeah.
And just feels kind of, yeah, directionless is the best way I'd describe
him. Yeah, no, you're 100%, 100% on that. Our finish counter, brought to you by Ludwig Borga, I believe it was... hold on now.
It was nine matches.
I was so disgusted, I just shut it down. But we had nine matches. I believe we had... Oh, hold on now. This is so classic that just this episode, this is what it did to me. I just, like, as soon as we stopped talking about it, I closed the window because I was like, no.
You just want to forget about it.
I'm done with this shit now. And I was like, and I was even by the end of the show debating, like, will I even do the finish counter? Because I was so up on a high after that, like, Sting DDP match, that by the end of the show, I was like, you took all my enthusiasm for the World Championship Wrestling mm-hmm. and you took it away. Even though, like I said at the top of the show, I didn't think it was the, like, I didn't think it was an excellent Nitro, but like apart from that booking decision in the main event, I could have come out of that show going, God, you know, I'm feeling pretty bouncy about WCW at the moment. We got 9 matches, 5 clean finishes, 2 disqualifications, and 2 matches with interference leading directly to a finish. Thank you all very much for listening to this episode of Nights of Nitro. We will be back in 2 weeks here with a very special edition of the show as we talk not only about the next episode of Thunder, but also the pilot for SmackDown. So stay tuned for that one. We'll see you in 2 weeks. Bye-bye.
Thanks everyone for listening to another episode of Days of Thunder. Days of Thunder was produced by Lee Malone and edited by me, Dave Ryan. Keep up to date with the show and find all the ways to listen to us. You can follow us on Twitter at WCW Thunderpod or click the Linktree link in our Twitter bio or in the show notes. I am at The Day to Dave on Twitter and Lee is at Malone_713. Days of Thunder is a part of the Voices of Wrestling podcast network. Follow the VOW network anywhere good podcasts are sold for more fine podcasts than you can shake a stick at. Thanks.